Jewish Education and Media is pleased to present L'Chaim, a program that highlights the people, issues, and events of importance to the Jewish community. Now here is your host, Rabbi Mark Golub.
I'm Mark Golub, and one of the things we enjoy doing most is introducing you to men and women you may not know, but who are doing amazing things for Jewish life and for the state of Israel today. And so on this edition of L'Chaim, I am so very pleased to introduce you to Shahar Azani, whose formal title at the Israeli Consulate in New York is Consul for Media Affairs. But everyone who has the pleasure of working with Shahar and knowing him understands that Shahar brings a remarkable breadth of knowledge, competence, and enthusiasm to every facet of consulate life. By the way, Shahar Azani has had a whirlwind career in a very short period of time. He served as deputy spokesperson for Israel's Ministry of Foreign Affairs. He comes to New York from the Israeli consulate in L.A., where he was consul for culture as well as media and public affairs. And before that, Shahar was Israel's deputy ambassador at its embassy in Nairobi, Kenya. And of course, if you're a regular viewer of our channel, you also know Shahar has his own series, Eye on Israel. And Shahar, it's so wonderful to have you sitting in this chair. Thank you very, very much.
It's my pleasure and honor to be here with you, Mark.
There are so many things I want to talk to you about and so many things I want you to talk to the audience about. But I want to begin first by asking you, how in the world does somebody so young and charismatic end up in the Israeli Foreign Ministry? How does that happen?
Well, you know, it's a lifelong dream. When you are born with a certain passion, you know, you ask yourself in the course of life, what do you want to do? What do you want to be when you grow up? And from a tender age, I knew, Mark, I knew that it's the path between Israel and the world. It's the Jewish people. Remember, think about growing up in Israel, of when I grew up in Israel, and when you have a single channel television, and the interactions you have with the world is a realization that there was the Holocaust, and the Yanuk trial, and the politics, and the region, and the immigration, and you understand, even as a young child growing up in Israel, that there is something there. It's not just like any other country on earth. And that passion leads you somewhere. I'll never forget one day when my mother was helping me doing my homework in math, and we go through the paper, and I see this thing, and it's diplomatic cadet course. And I asked my mother, what is that? She said, oh, this is to be a diplomat. And this is when the idea was ingrained in my mind. And to be honest, it's a miracle. The ability to be part of the Israeli Foreign Service, the application rate is about 20 people out of 4,000 on a biannual basis. It's, I don't know, somehow we were able to filter through the system.
That's wonderful.
But it's a great joy.
That's a wonderful. Your mother and father's names?
Shmuel and Shoshana.
Okay, are they both living?
Yeah, they're both alive. Wonderful. In Israel, retired.
Where were they born?
My father was born in Yemen, and at the age of 2 came to Israel, and my mother was born in Israel. My grandparents on either side were born in Yemen, which also brings a very interesting dimension to the platform.
You know,
because look at me. When you look at me and you go and speak at a shul, or you go and speak at a certain event, you kind of shatter the myth about Israel. In American public perception, an Israeli is most likely an ultra-Orthodox American Jew who lives in a settlement. I need to be Ashkenazi, I need to be religious, I need to have a beard, I'm 16, a wife, and 16 kids, and we need to live in a settlement where the kids are in the basement and I defend them in this cemented hall. And here I come, Shahar, who looks slightly different, who's not as ultra-Orthodox as one may think, and who tends to, so I hear, smile a bit. That in itself brings in a whole different package. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, I even did once in those lines to explain to our kids about the world. We were speaking at one of the Jewish summer camps. And the counselor said, Shahar, we would love it if you could come and speak to the kids in the barn, on the haystack. I said, terrific. Just don't tell them who's coming. And when I came, I took upon myself the personality of a Palestinian. And I spoke to them for about 10, 12 minutes as a Palestinian, because I wanted to show them that the world is a very diverse world, that what they view doesn't necessarily meet their expectations, that here I am, come to them as Bassam from Bethlehem, but it's actually Shahar from the consulate, and it makes them think. Mm-hmm. It makes them not take things for granted. It makes them research and explore. And at the end of the day, that's what advocacy is all about. It's not about taking my talking points. It's about realizing that the world may surprise you and to be ready through knowledge and information for that surprise.
Stereotypes often get in the way, yes?
Yes.
Both for American Jews and for Israelis.
Right.
So as someone who has seen it from both sides, what are some of the most upsetting stereotypes that you find American Jews have about Israel? And what is the stereotype that Israelis have about American Jews?
Well, let me do Americans and Israelis. So I can tell you that shattering stereotypes is a daily chore. It starts from when you have a meeting and you arrive at the meeting 10 minutes before and you wait kindly in the waiting hall for the time where you're met. How many times will I hear, you're an Israeli, we thought you're gonna be here half an hour later. To understand that congeniality is a part of the process. Mm-hmm. And that's also a lesson of advocacy. It's not always about what we say, it's about who we are. So one day, I go through customs between Toronto and New York. And as I pass through customs and I fill the form, I hand it up to the two ladies by the counter, and they look at me, and one tells the other, shocks, I lost the bet. So I'm asking, what bet did you lose? So she looks at, well, actually, when we were filling the forms, we were wondering where you're from. And we thought Brazil, maybe Spain, possibly Italy. I said, okay, but why not Israeli, as I'm showing her my passport? She said, well, that was a tricky part because you seem to smile too much for an Israeli. Why? Because the geopolitics dictates that we Israelis need to be continuously gloomy and somber, and in many ways so is Israel advocacy. Well, we're not. And at the same time, if you're able to convey that message through a smile, through a look, when you speak before a public audience and the only thing you want them to leave with is, that seems like a nice chap, I'd have beer with him. I don't know, the rest is unimportant because once you open the mind, once you open the door to the soul, the mind is open.
And what's the stereotype on the other side of the ocean?
I think that there is a huge gap between Israelis and American Jews, if I want to relate to that very important point now. We have a situation in Israel where religion has taken a certain place in politics. It created a reality which is surfacing all the time, in which many Israelis don't exercise religion in any way, don't interact with Judaism the right way, and some of them may not even visit shul for years, a rabbi, not to mention. And these Israelis satisfy, we as Israelis, find our Judaism manifested in the fact that we're holding an Israeli ID, an Israeli passport. We live in the state of Israel, which is a Jewish state. Yom Kippur is like nowhere else on earth. The holidays, Chagim, are terrific. I don't have to go to shul to feel. I don't have to go to shul to find shidduch or to find a nice Jewish girl because mostly I'm surrounded by them. And then they come to the United States of America. And when those Israelis whom I've met here in New York and in Los Angeles and elsewhere come to the U.S., it's a different ballgame. It's not a Jewish state. And it's not a necessity that you're not going to see cars on Yom Kippur. And if you don't go to shul, shul is not going to come knocking on your door. And if you don't give these values to your children, they're not going to encounter these values. So first-generation Israelis still have that connection. Mm-hmm. They would speak in Hebrew, they would live Israel, they would surf the websites, they would maintain that connection. Second generation, now it's starting to get tricky. The kids, it's easier for them English. Third generation, I don't even want to go there. And
what does that mean?
Some of them are so far apart from anything Jewish and anything Israel.
Israelis.
Up to a point where some of the Israelis I met here prided themselves in my ears, saying that, my kids don't even know Hebrew. They speak perfect English.
And they meant it in a positive way.
Absolutely. And this is something that if we don't address, then the fate of the Jewish people on both sides of the Atlantic will be hurt in such a way. This is one of the crucial aspects of our work. And what I say relates also to the American Jewish establishment. Why? Because when you think about American Jewish establishment, you think about shul and high holidays and a rabbi and a community. It's all around there. And when Israelis don't speak that language, they don't feel comfortable to go to shul on high holidays, They don't understand how it works, how the structure of that community works. They don't understand, or truly takes them time to understand the challenges of being a Jew who lives in a non-Jewish society. There is a gap, and there is lack of dialogue mm-hmm. between the American Israelis and American Jews. And there is a huge effort now from various parts of the country to try and galvanize the Israeli community, create a group out of them, reach out to the American Jewish community, interact more so that we get to know each other. The problem of religion also manifests itself in Israel. And how much do Israelis in Israel know about the United States, about Israel's position in the world, and about the American Jewish community? Being a diplomat for the state of Israel in the U.S. doesn't only mean that Shahar and his colleagues need to go out and speak about Israel to everyone. It's also very much about taking whatever is here and sending it back home. Because mm-hmm. that bond between the state of Israel and the one community on earth that is a pillar of Israel's defense, without which life in Israel would be far more difficult, is a fire we have to keep.
I want to now take a half step back because I want to come to this very idea in one moment. You seem to get it, and I'm curious how that happened for you. So, for example, what was the Judaism in your own home in Israel? When you were growing up, first of all, do you have any siblings?
Yes. What? I'm the oldest. I have three more.
Three more?
Yeah, sister and two brothers.
Okay. Fairly close in age?
Fairly close in
okay.
age.
So you're growing up with your mother and father and your right. three siblings.
Right. And my grandparents, who lived with us in the house.
Interesting.
So it's a Where big was the family. House? Ramat Gan, when they made the Aliyah from Yemen, and they settled in one of those neighborhoods for new immigrants, and mother and father went out to work, and grandmother and grandfather were with the kids at home, helping, you know, to keep them and take care of them.
So you had a close relationship with your grandparents.
Very close relationship.
Did your parents, by the way, have a hard time coming from Yemen? You know, Israel has evolved over time, of
right.
course.
Right.
And there was once a time when there was an enormous distinction between the Ashkenazi and the Sephardi.
Right.
And it was really not until Menachem Begin became prime minister that all of a sudden there was sort of legitimacy conferred on the Sephardic population of Israel.
Right.
Did your parents have a hard time?
Well, I think every immigrant who came to Israel had a hard time, regardless of where you came from. Mm-hmm. The difficulties of you know, of a newcomer to a state, the difficulties of this incredible fusion of cultures, where people come from incredibly diverse cultures. When you think about the Ethiopian community and what they had in Addis Ababa and elsewhere and what they're facing now in Israel. When you think of the Russian Jewish community, when you think about the Yemenites and the Moroccans, I think we all had our issues. Yes, it was difficult for them.
Did it make them angry at all?
If at all, and that's something I really took from them, it propelled them with great energy. They knew that whatever opportunity they were given by the state of Israel, they will do their utmost best to give their children, us, the better place in the state of Israel to move forward. And it's that energy, that enthusiasm, that commitment that propelled me as an individual to appreciate, and that's a gift. To be able, and I acknowledge that gift, to be able to appreciate something while it's happening.
Okay.
To say, I'm not taking this for granted. Mm-hmm. The fact that my parents work so hard every day and my grandparents keep an eye on us, the kids, they do it for a reason. So I am owe it to my parents and my grandparents to take that next step.
It's a gift you get. You understand? Because if you don't understand it,
right.
you become a different person.
Right.
Again, come down to the Judaism of your household. To what extent is your home a secular Jewish home? To what extent is there Yiddishkeit Judaism
right.
in the home that you're growing up in?
You know how being secular sometimes is a religion in itself?
Yeah.
So no, my home is very much traditional, with all of the holidays, with going to shul, with rabbi, with, I mean, that's what I grew up on. And I'll tell you even more. In my neighborhood, first grade, right? Shachar of the first grade. It's a story I've never told before. There are two schools in the proximity of where we lived. One is a secular Israeli, and one is a national religious Israeli. And I speak with my parents. I always think to myself, what propelled me at the first grade?
Yes.
Say, which school do you want to go to? You have the two options. Which one do you want to go? And I tell them the religious one. And that's how I, who come from a traditional we're not ultra-Orthodox, we're not too observant, we're traditional. And I go to a Jewish religious school, not the sec from the secular system, the usual government system, but the national religious in my neighborhood. And that was the case throughout my education. From the first grade until I graduated high school, I went through the semi-modern Orthodox, if you want, yeshiva system. From the elementary to Bnei Akiva to the high school, which was Amit by Bar Ilan University. So that has been my life. And that has been a great gift. Because now, being Shahar that I am able to converse with my tradition. I can go to the Gemara easily. I can, when I go to shuls on the weekends and discuss the Parsha, I can do it. Mm-hmm. And I'm happy to be able to do it, not only through my work as an Israeli, not only through my Jewish roots, but even when you speak to the general public and you're able to reference religion in such a way. It empowers you as an individual. Therefore, it is absolutely essential that I do the same. Eleanor and I do the same with our children at home. When we sing Shalom Aleichem, for Shabbat dinner, when we have that institution, the wonderful Jewish institution of Shabbat dinner, where we get to sit together and spend quality time. By goodness, you know, you go through the week, especially in a place like New York, you've no idea where the week went. But you get this cherished time where if you don't go through the Shabbat dinner, you ask yourself, what's happening? How come we're not having Shabbat dinner this week? And the kids appreciate it, and the whole family just sits and discusses and speaks the week and the plights and the joys and the week ahead and the week that we've had in Israel, and it's a tremendous experience, Mark.
Oh.
It's a tremendous experience. I think it's where the connection comes in. I was, traditional in that sense in Israel. I came to appreciate it so much more when I took upon myself the diplomatic mission. Because when you're in the diaspora, in the galut, which is a word I don't like, but it depicts a fact, you understand. When you're in Nairobi, Kenya, so close to the equatorial skies with the stars above you, and you welcome Shabbat with freshly baked challah, you feel that much closer to home. When you welcome your guests to your Shabbat dinner table, and you do the kiddush with them, and you explain to them Jewish tradition, you feel at home. You learn to appreciate all of those things that we as Israelis, and let's say Shachar as an Israeli, took for granted growing up. And that's also a great gift.
You understand it applies to Jews everywhere. What you're describing, this extraordinary gift of Shabbat, especially the Shabbat table on Friday night.
Right.
You give me chills when you talk about it. And of course, you also bring back to me the wonderful memories I had both as a child and then as a parent with my own five children around this table, and how I wanted to be for my grandchildren and great-grandchildren as well. And yet at the same time, there are many Israelis who don't understand what you're talking about. And there are many American Jews who don't know what you're talking about. What I am thrilled with is I know that there are people watching you right now who may say to themselves for the first time, I want what Shachar had. I want it for myself, I want it for my kids, and I want it for my family. So I love the fact that you describe it just that way. And it helped shape who you became. One more question about you growing up, then I'll extend it to the Israel.
Let me just tell you one more story.
Sure.
Nairobi has one shul.
One shul.
One shul. And I was highly valuable because coming in a place like Nairobi to shul, I came with Israeli security, which meant you had three for minion. And you can nothing is comparable to the experience of being there in that beautiful shul, fighting for minion. Realizing that
meaning you had a hard time getting
10. A hard time getting 10, where you have over 100 families living in the city, 100 Israeli families and 10 Jewish families who reside in the Nairobi environs. And when I asked them once, I'll never forget what one of the ones told me. He said, oh, Shahar, we hear there is something about you. I said, what is it about me? He said, you, my friend, you are a shul goer. True story, a shul goer. And that was the first time I realized there was a problem. What have we done as Israelis that have taken people so far away from the mere notion of synagogue and Jewish religion? Mm-hmm. And what can we do to mend our ways and to correct it? And that's, to me personally, one of my, if not the most important mission, with all due respect to advocacy. And I love advocacy, but this is part of building our community and our nation. What more can I do as an Israeli who learned and got the gift from the State of Israel of realizing what this is to convey the message to my brothers and sisters.
Yeah. Who are you? You know, I keep saying to myself, you don't, it's just the truth. You don't speak in the way that we're used to hearing Israeli diplomats, especially of your age, speak. And it comes back to what you said earlier. You know, on the one hand, if you live in Israel, everything around you is Jewish. Right. And the calendar is Jewish. Right. And the climate is Jewish. Right. And the calendar in a larger sense. You know, in America, you're always saying, is Rosh Hashanah too early or too late?
Right.
In Israel, Sukkot is at Sukkot, you know? Right. There's nothing like Sukkot in Israel. There's nothing like Pesach right. in Israel.
True.
At the same time, if an Israeli feels that simply because he speaks Israel and walks the land that Abraham walked, that there is Torah there or Jewishness there, Shahar, there can be something enormously missing there. And very often we will meet Israelis whose argument is, oh, you American Jew, you have to go to synagogue.
Right.
Yes, you have to worry about kashrut.
Right.
You have to worry about Yom Kippur. Right. You have to worry. In Israel, we don't do any of that, but by living in the land, we are Jewish. And there is a distinction between Jewish and Israeli.
Right.
And you're speaking to that, correct?
Right. Absolutely.
And it's what you alluded to at the very beginning of this program, that there is an issue that Israelis are sensitive to, more and more sensitivity
right.
about the difference, the gap
right.
between being an Israeli, a Hebrew-speaking person,
right.
as opposed to being a Jew.
Right.
Somehow, because of who you are and where you came from and who your mother and father were, you got both.
Right.
You love the Jewish people,
right.
the Jewish tradition,
right.
which
do.
Lives for you right. in Israel,
right.
correct?
Absolutely.
And when you go out of Israel, you take Israel with you in
right.
some way. And Jewish peoplehood goes
right.
with you.
Right.
And you understand how you and I are linked together.
Right.
Before we even knew each other,
Absolutely.
We were linked together. So my question for you is, before I ask you all the questions that everybody wants to ask an Israeli diplomat,
right.
what do you feel Israel can do to bridge that gap so that more and more young Israelis understand it's not enough to live ba'aretz?
The answer is very simple, and it is basically three answers. That's one, education, education, education. Very simple, clear cut and to the point. I was once asked, as an Israeli diplomat, I have a joy of sending my children to the American Jewish school system. And in one of our discussions we had over Shabbat dinner with Israeli friends, they said, oh, Shahar, but the public school in this neighborhood is amazing. It's one of the best in the country. What, there is a UN school. Terrific. They give the kids iPads and iMacs and iThis and iThat. Why don't you send your kids there? So there are two answers to that. One is I asked them. I asked my kids. When we came to New York, and I took both of them, my 10-year-old daughter and my 7-year-old son, I took them to the public school, and I took them to the UN school, and I took them to the Jewish school. And I knew what I wanted for my kids. But since we were rooted out of Israel so quickly, in a matter of 2 months we were in New York and going away from the family, and I wanted to see what they're comfortable with. And I will never forget the answer they gave me. Consulted, right, 10 and 7. And they tell Eleanor and me, you know, we thought about this, Abba Ima, and our heart is with the Hebrews. That speaks volumes to where I want my future to be as a people, where I want my children to be. Because when you think about education, okay, so you go to a public school and you get top A's, A++++ in math and science and English, but at the age of 18, when you look at the world around you and you are this terrifically smart engineer, something is missing. The neshama, the soul will continue seeking for something. So yes, you can excel in everything you want, but as a Jewish people, we already have such a huge chunk of neshama in who we are for thousands of years. It's a crime that we will send our kids at the age of 18 to look around and seek such neshama in the east or the west or the south or the north, where we have it right here. And if we are wise enough as parents to give it to our children, then we're able to teach them something about themselves and let them choose. And if they want to augment it when they reach the right age or to have some more experience, that's fine. But they have the core. And that is the effort that you'll see in Israel today as well. As an Israeli diplomat, I see many of our leaders come and go, especially in a place like New York. I can sit in Nairobi and wish for the deputy assistance of the major director who is in charge on certain issues to maybe come. But here, God bless, you know, the Chinese, right? Have your an interesting life? I do. So you have a lot of visitors come in, and you get first-hand impression, and you understand, even in the last elections, Israelis said something about our society. We said something about how we want to view our society. When you look into the draft bill, when you look into the economic situation, we understand today that there is a lot of work we need to do inwards. And that work is about Judaism and Israel. You'll talk to some high schools in Israel who may not know who David Ben-Gurion is, our founding prime minister. So this is an issue that's heavily dealt with and on everybody's mind. And in my small little capacity as a diplomat, I do all that I can to expose America and American Jewish society just because of its Jewish foundation to Israelis. There is much more to American Jewry than donors. Mm-hmm. Because there are issues of essence here that relate to freedom of choice and religion and where Judaism wants to go and your comfort level of going where you want to go as a Jew. And try to introduce, because, okay, I'm going to say something controversial a bit. I'm going to dare now. I get, as a diplomat, a lot of questions about freedom of religion in Israel. And I always ask one question. You come to Israel and you want to exercise this freedom or that freedom. I grew up, I never saw a woman putting kippah on her head. I didn't know what Reconstructionist or Reform or Conservative were. Now, how do I know, as a traditional Israeli, what this is? If I go out and I'm lucky enough to be one of those 20 who gets to be a diplomat and explores the world, hallelujah. But if I don't, then the only way I encounter these notions is through conflict. I want to do something in Israel, but I can't, so I complain. So some people would go on certain shows on international networks and would speak ill of Israel's religious establishment, and I'm not clearing anybody of any fault or guilt. But this is the interaction. Now think, let's go to the Israeli mindset. I'm an Israeli. My name is Yossi. I live in Be'er Sheva, 8,000 miles away from the United States of America. I am used to being bashed by international media. I see Israel criticism everywhere I go, from some stories on the New York Times to the way CNN covers or NBC or anywhere else. And I'm used to being attacked all the time. And my only interaction with certain kind of Judaism is to see the representatives attacking Israel. That puts you in a certain place. We go back to the idea I mentioned before. It's not about what you say. It's about who you are. Mm-hmm. When was the last time such a movement would come to Israel and engage with Israel's civil authority on cleaning beaches, where it calls out on members of their belief and way and Israelis to come together for a special operation where we clean the Tel Aviv beach. We go for a walk from Yafo to the northern part bordering Herzliya and we just clean the beach together. Yes, true. It's not about factions of Judaism. It's about us as human beings. It's about a mode of introduction where we need to be introduced. Israelis need to be introduced. We have birthright here where American Jews can come to Israel and explore Israel. What about us Israelis? We need to get to know America. We need to get to know our brothers and sisters in America, to go beyond the stereotypes. It's not only about donors and a plaque on the wall. Mm-hmm. It's about people mm-hmm. and faith and future, not only past.
I want to push you one more moment. Education, education, education. You know, we've said that for as long as I've been alive, I've heard that. And every so many years, somebody says, now we've really got to do it right.
Right.
Again, every decade, it's as if nothing we've ever done is right. But now we've got it.
Now we've got
it. I want to add a word, and I want you to tell me whether you think it sounds right to you or not. It wasn't simply education for you or for me. It was an experience. You grew up with an experience of being Jewish in a way that touched your soul. And then your parents, and by the way, it sounds to me like you were part of the process, and then you were given content to go with that experience. What I worry about is, I don't know how we're going to give the experience to people who are outside. And you know, people often say to me, what are you doing with Shalom TV? What's the reason? And one of the things I'm trying to do is give people, first of all, access to you and people like you, because there are so many people who are just eloquent in explaining what this Jewish thing is. Right. But also, people are experiencing you right now. It's what you said before. Part of what your advocacy is getting, letting them get to know you as an unusual, loving human being. And Shalom TV is trying to give people an opportunity to get inside Jewishness, to experience it. Although, okay, so it's through a television set.
Right.
But it begins there. And then people who are sometimes timid will take the next step and go to a synagogue or go to a Jewish group.
Right.
But they first have to feel that they... And what I'm saying to you is the Israelis have the same problem. I want there to be a way in which people who, whether in America or Israel, who are not experiencing the kind of Jewish home you had, the Shabbat table you had and are now having for your children, that somehow we create context in which their experience then can be filled with the knowledge that gives them the ability to articulate to themselves and to others why this Jewish people and state of Israel and the Jewish tradition is so magnificent. So it's, you know, why should I ask you? Because I ask you everything every time I see you. Is there something you would say to Israelis and to American Jews about how you do open up the experience of Jewishness and the state of Israel so that people can embrace it the way you do? What's that added feature that education then fills? It can't be, you can't educate on nothing.
Right.
You educate into something. Do you know what I'm trying to say to you?
So education is a very important component, but education in itself is also able sometimes to create such an environment through activities, through extracurricular, not only through school, to bring you to a reality where you have to encounter your Judaism in certain junctions.
In
a positive way. In engaging with the children, learning from the children, with the children about yourself. I want to tell you that this setting is extremely important to me. In many ways, you know, I go to various places and I try to take myself and share with people. You can't do it everywhere all the time. Being here with you now, Mark, gives me an opportunity in our family bonfire to speak out to thousands of us, to explore the message together, to think to themselves, how can we converse Israel and Judaism in an optimistic way, in a way that is carried with a smile, with hopes for the future? You mentioned education. It's always on the table. It's true. It's like the saying, Israel is at a crucial junction.
Always.
This is a crucial time for Israel now. It's true. But there is so much we can say about others, other experiences. There is something we can say about us. What have we done now and here today? Have we cast a ballot? Have we went to a certain center? Have we engaged with the community in somehow? There is a variety of programs now that take place around the city, trying to bring Israelis to the Jewish tradition. Which is called Chofshi beManhattan, Free in Manhattan, which is at a Stephen S. Wise synagogue, where they basically, for last high holiday, sponsor tickets for Israelis. That's not coming out of nowhere.
Mm-hmm.
The need is there.
Mm-hmm.
When you look into education, look into what happened in Israel's recent elections. You had a new party, Yesh Atid. Forget about political discussions or how well or how not well or how good or... The fact is that they rose to power based on a platform that calls for equality in budget, equality in drafting, equality in education. You have a party, you have leaders in the coalition who call for more Israel and religious studies and call for more Zionist studies and the realization that something is being done. Is it the right thing? We can always hope. We can share. We can do. No longer are we passive viewers. We are part of the equation. And if we understand we have the power to change, it's not about sitting on our chairs or in the living room and say, oh, it's true. Oh, it's a very Jewish movie. I do all the time. But then I get up and I try to do. When I go and speak and people would come out and say, you know what, Shahar, that's amazing. I really want to do this and that. I said, okay, so what are we doing next? When is the next event you're holding? For I saw somebody who attended my event at one of the shuls recently. Young guy, student in college, and he came and said, Shahar, that's awesome, I love it. I said, okay, great, so when are you hosting me? When do I get a chance to speak to your community, your people, your fellow students in class, out of class? You just tell me when and where, and I'll be there. I'm availing myself to you. If you pick it up, meet the challenge and do it. Because that's the way to move ahead. It's not about sitting and complaining. It's about looking forward. And nowadays, with social media, with the gatekeepers off, with the accessibility of messaging, if it's a good enough message, it's going to go viral. We can make a difference. No longer is it gloom and doom about everything and how difficult this is and how difficult that is. We can all complain and whine endlessly, and we do it so well. But we can do more than just that. And even if it's one click a day, mm-hmm. one attention a day, you know, when I go, you think about speaking in schools. I remember one of my most challenging speaking engagements was when I went to speak to fourth graders in one of the Jewish schools. What do you tell fourth graders? I mean, how do you take that package called you have a man in a suit who comes to speak to them? What do you do? And I'll never forget, I sit there, I take the flag from the bima. I just sit there, and we speak about what it means to be an Israeli, that state with that national anthem and that flag, and what does that flag mean to them, and what does it mean for somebody to take that flag and move from one place to the other with it, and what does that flag stand for? Because it doesn't stand for just a Hebrew-speaking European proximity nation that happens to be in the Middle East. If you lose that core, you're losing Israel. For Israel is founded as a Jewish state. There is a meaning to being Jewish. I want my fellow Israelis to understand why some of the soldiers on Golan Heights receive a package from the Jewish community in Minnesota. When I had the pleasure of accompanying orphans, IDF orphans, on a visit to Canada, on a bar mitzvah trip. And we were hosted by a very generous member of the Jewish community who held a party for them, which was terrific. And one of the kids asks me and says, Shahar, I just tell me something. Why does he care about me? Why do they care about us? He doesn't know who I am. They've never met my father. So why do they care? And I think that question speaks volumes. And I take that question and wrap it and put it in my backpack. And it goes with me wherever I go.
That's wonderful, Shahar. We've talked about the Jewish tradition in you.
Right.
If I say to you, do you love Israel? What do you say to me?
With all my heart.
Say it again.
With all my heart. To the people of Israel, to the state of Israel, I am committed, I am privileged, I am honored to be where I am, to be able to realize a dream of standing at the forefront of representing my people to the nations as a Jewish state. And that means a lot as a Jewish state. When I was in Nairobi, one of the most wonderful connections with the local community. And I don't know if you're aware, but if you remember, in December 2007, there were public riots as a result of the elections in Kenya. A lot of people were injured, internally displaced people, and I'm not going to go into that story, but a few months later, just before I leave Nairobi on my way to Los Angeles, by the way, not knowing what to expect from Los Angeles, but again, that's a different story, and I'm supposed to give a last talk, and in one of those community places where I used to speak, there was a very big church where they wanted me to come every third Sunday of the month to deliver an Israel message. And to that last speaking engagement, they said, Shahar, we want an hour. What? I said, no, not 10 minutes. We want an hour. This is your goodbye talk. We want you to come for an hour and talk to us. We're going to have, 3,500 people in the hall. Think what you want to say, but we want you to really feel it. So I'm an Israeli diplomat. What could I do when I come on that Sunday to speak before 3,500 people? So I rummage through the books, and I think to myself, hey, my Jewish education comes in handy. And I take the Gemara. And in the Gemara, I take Tractate of Gittin, and I take the story of Kamtza and Bar Kamtza, the story of these two gentlemen, according to the Gemara, because of whom Jerusalem was destroyed during the rebellion against the Romans. And the story is all about somebody who was disrespected and who was invited to this wonderful gala dinner by mistake, and the host wants to throw him out in front of everyone. But Shahar, what does that have to do with anything? what does Gittin have to do with 3,500 Christians on a Sunday when you're an Israeli diplomat? You're not a rabbi. Well, I'm not. But I am an Israeli diplomat. I do represent the Jewish state. And the great lesson that that Gemara teaches us is the national ramifications of social behaviors. For when you throw somebody out of an event in the presence of all of the leaders of the nation at that time, and the Gemara says it's not because of the host, it's because of the fact that the leadership of Israel at that time looked the other way when such atrocity took place. In this respect, exactly, they permitted it to happen. That is the reason Israel was punished in such a way. And to come to my fellow Kenyans and tell them that social behavior has national ramifications is the most crucial lesson for a country that experienced 7 months before such an event in which social behaviors impacted the fate of the national, of the Republic of Kenya on a national level. That's something that I could give them because I represent the state of Israel, the Jewish state founded on these principles.
So I want you to have a chance to speak to the type of thing we hear all the time
right.
from even well-meaning Jews here in America, who the way they frame it, Shahar, is I support the state of Israel. I may even love the state of Israel.
Right.
I visit the state of Israel. But I want Israel to be the best of the Jewish tradition. And
right.
I don't want it somehow to fall into patterns that in some way betray Jewish values. As you and I are sitting here right now, Ari Shavit is in America. He is an author. He writes for Haaretz. He has written a book, My Promised Land. He's going on many of the talk shows, television and radio, NPR. And I'm going to quote a passage that I'm going to quote him. And then I want someone like you, who has a passion for being Jewish and for the state of Israel, to try to put into context for us what your reaction is. It's not like I want to tell you, I'm not looking for you to tell me what to feel. We want to understand what does an Israeli, with your perspective, feel when he hears someone say this. The great challenge for Israel is that there's an inherent contradiction between our values, which are basically democratic, liberal, humane values, and the brutal reality we live in. And by brutal reality, Shavit is talking about the occupation of Palestinians on the West Bank. And I said to myself, there is no one I would rather hear speak to this than you. Because what I'm looking for is, I'm not looking for a political answer here. I want to understand what a loving, thoughtful, committed Israeli feels when he too understands that Israel is in control of. I personally resent the word occupation, but it's the word that has become the parlance of our time. Israel is in control, absolutely administrative control, of the West Bank, what some people call Judea Samaria, biblically Judea Samaria. And there are X million number of Palestinians, Arabs, living there who are now living under, in some form or another, control of the Israeli people and the Israeli government and the Israeli army. And there are Israelis who argue that the occupation of the West Bank has done enormous damage to the Israeli soul. And American Jews here, many of whom have never seen the West Bank, also they don't realize every time they go to Jerusalem, they're in the West Bank. If they go to the West, if they visit the Western Wall, if they visit where now this third section has been established, they're in the West Bank, because at one point we could not pass the Mandelbaum right. Gate and go anywhere near the old city.
Right.
But they've never seen Ariel. They've never seen Hebron. They've never seen Maale Adumim or Efrat. And yet they feel somehow that the West Bank is, the control of Israel, the West Bank is somehow a violation of Israeli and Jewish values. So I want to know from your perspective, and again, I wish, you know, I'm taking you out of the role
right.
of the consulate. I'm asking you simply
as Shahar
Azani, a lovely Israeli who grew up in a lovely Israeli home, what do you do? And you were in the Israeli army.
Right.
So what do you do with all this? And we will learn It's not like I want you to tell us
right.
what we should think.
I'll tell you
I want to understand what right. you think and feel.
This is, as Ari Shavit states, a brutal reality in many ways. The way I feel about the political realities is that as an Israeli, I have an obligation to do all that I can to make things right, but at the same time realize that I can only do what I can do and cannot do what I cannot do. As a young Israeli, I watched the signing of the Oslo Accords, the White House lawn, the auspicious ceremony, the beautiful, incredibly celebratory, not to mention euphoric situation where Mashiach is coming. And tears rolled down my eyes. I knew I'm going to live in a different generation. I have the opportunity here for my kids maybe not to go to the army at 18. Maybe they can go to college. And a few months later, I watch at the same screen and hear that a friend of mine from my class in high school, 6 months in the army, was killed in a bus attack by Gaza, where Islamic Jihad took a car bomb and stuck right by the Egged bus and killed him and several of his friends. I realize there is no other way to describe this slaughter as brutal. But at the same time, I ask myself, are we as Israelis doing all that we can to change that reality? Do we do what we can to bring something else to the equation? Studying law, I got the opportunity to acquaint myself with an incredible world, to realize that back at the end of the 80s, not 2007, there is a Palestinian farmer who sells his fruits and vegetables on a certain place. And one day, the Israeli military commander in that city decides that he can't work on that Sunday. The market needs to be closed. But that farmer knows that that's the only day he can sell his produce. Otherwise, he's going to lose it all. There is not going to be, he won't be able to provide for his family that week. So that Palestinian petitions to Israel's Supreme Court in Jerusalem. Think about that for a minute. Israel never officially annexed the West Bank. So this is not an Israeli territory. The Palestinian is neither an Israeli citizen nor an Israeli resident. However, the Supreme Court, having all of the excuses in the book, and I've read the book, can tell him, go away, our court is busy. Take his claim, discuss it, and issues a verdict, end of the 80s. We need to look into the situation like the reasonable commander would. And the reasonable army commander would balance the Palestinian right to provide for his family and the army security military needs of the area. Therefore, it is the decision of this tribunal as a reasonable commander to allow for the opening of the market between the hours of this is what I want to see Israelis do. We cannot change what we cannot change. I cannot make myself, with my own power, make that 16-year-old Palestinian not wield the knife, for he understands it's not a sheep he's looking at, but a soldier and a human being. But I can do all that I can to do what I can to make life better, to change life for the better, to fight for any kind of settlement. You know, I hear a lot of criticism sometimes from the right. When I was speaking in one place where I was told, you're a liar, talking about two-state solution, talking about peace, it's never going to happen. It's time you realize that. And the only answer I could give him was, if I, as an Israeli, not as a Manhattanite, as an Israeli, think the way you do, and I realize there is no hope, not even a glimmer, a shrapnel of hope that things will be different in the future, it'll be very difficult for me to raise my children in Israel. I need to know that I will do all that I can. When Prime Minister Barak, and I'm not speaking as a spokesperson, but as an Israeli, like any Israeli would tell you on the street, we try all the time. But if I have a disagreement with my neighbor, and we decide that we need to sit down and talk, and while we sit down and talk, I know that that neighbor is inciting all of the neighborhood against me. That's not bona fide talk. I'm going to stop now. Don't think about Israel and Palestinians. Think about Joe and Jim. When you do it in your neighborhood, when I spoke to teachers, first grade teachers, coming to a conference at the UN, and I tried to explain Israel and the UN, I said, you're a teacher. If you were to see a kid in your class that's being ostracized and boycotted by his friends, and that during playtime he's kept on the side, and during lessons, he's continuously lambasted. Would you do something about this? Would that trouble you in any way? So the teacher said, absolutely, that's our role as educators. So what applies for first grade applies for second, third, and the UN General Assembly. And when it comes to Israel and the nations, the truth needs to be spoken. So the question is not only national, and are we doing what we can to reach out? And we are. Only today the Prime Minister said, during the visit of the French President, come to Jerusalem, he called on Abu Mazen. We will go to Ramallah. We know that as far as we are concerned, we want to do what we can to safeguard the future of our children. We can't change everything. And that's also something we have to understand. Even though we're congenial and nice and we really try hard, it's not all of the keys are with us. We can't change ingrained hate. And that brings me to the last human point. Just the other day, on September 13th, 2013, I woke up to realize something. I realized that it's been 20 years. 20 years since the signing of the Oslo Accords. 20 years, it just was just yesterday. I was just there watching TV with Clinton and Rabin and Arafat, and everybody was there. Where have these 20 years gone? And in that time, in 93, 94, I'll never forget, there was a show, the Friday night major news in Israel, and Ilana Dayan at the time, one of the prominent reporters in Israel, interviews a young Palestinian child at the age of 9. And she shows him, they're there on the hills in the West Bank, and she shows him, points towards Jerusalem, and says, "What do you see?" That answer is also in my backpack. He said, "I see the sons of monkeys and pigs, and one day I will purge Jerusalem of that presence." And I'm thinking to myself now, is he 29 today? Where does he live? Is he dead, alive, in prison? Has he ever killed Jews just for the sake of being Jewish? Did he leave the Middle East? Where is he now? What could we have done in the course of 20 years to encourage this people-to-people dialogue? What have we done to make sure that it's not anti-Semitism and anti-Israel that's being taught in the schools? What can we do more to bridge the gaps between people, not only between Saar Barakat and Tzipi Livni, but also because Joe and Ismail and Yosef, how can we bring them together so that in 20 years, which is going to be tomorrow, and you know, Mark, mm-hmm. it's going to be tomorrow, mm-hmm. we're going to wake up and say, what have we done? And that is our biggest challenge in living with such a brutal reality. What can we do as Israelis, as individuals, as members of the Jewish state?
And what's the answer?
You know, there is a branch of our foreign ministry. It's called Mashav, Israel Center for International Cooperation. It works under zero budget. Its engine is the passion of the people, the experts, the know-howers, the leaders on campuses who would call us when they're on semester break and say, what can we do for the world? And this Mashav was established by Golda Meir back at the end of the 50s when she visited Africa. And it's a terrific story, which still takes place today. When she said it's our obligation as a young nation to reach out to the newly decolonized nations of Africa, what inspiration, what wind beneath the wings of the Jewish state. And her work then is embedded in this institution called Mashav, Israel Center for International Cooperation. And I used to send experts when I was in Nairobi to places from South America to Zambia to Malawi to Brazil to Argentina to Israel. And I always ask myself, why is it that I can have them sent to Zambia, but they can't drive to Ramallah, 45 minutes away? What, there aren't any agricultural issues that they can help? They can. Why can't they help? Because they're Jewish. That's the reason they can't step foot there and reach out between the peoples. But it works, Mark. Gratitude works. We say in Hebrew or Jewish, hakarat hatov, to realize and thank for what you have. When I stepped foot in Nairobi, there wasn't a ceremony official that wasn't opened with an official gratitude for Israel. That's something weird for Israelis. Gratitude? You wanna thank us for what? I thought you were gonna criticize me for the occupation. No. Thank you. Thank you for being the first on the scene in 1998 when the embassy in Nairobi was bombarded. And the first guys on the scene were not even the IDF. It was the Israeli community in Nairobi that came with its heavy machinery to save people from the wreckage. Second were Israel's defense force, home front defense, where they came and assisted. The result of which was a few years later working together on building a Kenyan unit to assist in Africa. This is what we can do. Acts of gratitude.
You know, you do understand that when Shavi talks about brutality, he's talking about the brutality that he sees policies of the Israeli government inflicting on the Palestinians. I'm not sure what that is. And I don't ever want to seem to be insensitive. And the Israelis I speak to, In my day-to-day contact with Israelis, when I'm in Israel, Shahar, you tell me if I'm being romantic. I do not talk to Israelis who don't express to me an empathy for the Palestinians. I almost never find any Israeli who hates Palestinians, even if they've killed people they know. There's some sort of like, it's just tragic.
Right.
I don't feel that the Israeli people want to impose anything of malice on the Palestinian people. And if there was a way in which somehow two peoples could share the land in a more peaceful way, my overwhelming sense is that except for a very small sliver on the far, far right, the Israeli people are ready to embrace and cooperate and even help the Palestinians and draw. There's enormous regard for some of the intelligence of the Palestinians. Let's share.
Right.
So my own feeling is that when I read about the brutality, and I'm not, you know, you're not here to criticize or to laud Shavit, but I'm only saying this to you. I don't want our viewers not to understand that you and I don't understand what Shavit is talking about.
Right.
But what you have said is so important for us all to hear. And you put it in a context and in a perspective that we, as American Jews and as Americans, need to hear. You are extraordinary. Kol tuv ha'atzlacha. You are the best of what the Jewish people in the state of Israel produce. And I am honored to be your friend, and I want you here in this table often, often, often.
As often as I can.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mark. Thank you for giving me the stage.
Thank you. The thoughts of Shahar Azani, who's Consul for Media Affairs at the Israeli Consulate in New York City, and the host of Eye on Israel right here. Of course, as always, I invite you to be in touch with me with any thoughts you may have. Share your thoughts to anything Shahar has said on this edition of L'Chaim. Please email me, write me, post it on our Facebook wall, tweet me. I look forward to hearing from many of you. And as always, if you want to be in touch with this extraordinary human being, Shahar Azani, you email me. I will forward your emails on to him. And again, you do extraordinary work, and it's an honor to sit with you. It's an honor to learn from you. It's an honor to share dinner with you. We will do many, many wonderful things together.
Thank you, Mark.
Kol tuv. Kol tuv. Until the next time, I'm Mark Golub. L'chaim, my friends, to life.
We would be pleased to send a complimentary DVD of this program to anyone who wishes to support Shalom TV with a tax-deductible gift of $36, double chai or more, to the nonprofit organization Jewish Education in Media. Simply visit the Shalom TV website homepage and click on the Donate button to make a donation by PayPal or your credit card. And please indicate the program for which you would like a DVD. Or you can send your tax-deductible check made out to JEM, Post Office Box 180, Riverdale Station, Bronx, New York, 10471. And again, please remember to indicate which program you would like to receive on DVD with our compliments. And we thank you for your kind support.
L'Chaim is a presentation of Jewish Education in Media.